Good morning, everybody. Today we'll see the next topic, that is the middle ear. In last lecture, we have seen the external ear and tympanic membrane. So in the middle ear, we will see under following headings, that is introduction, situation, where it is situated, what are the communications of middle ear, size and shape of middle ear, what are the boundaries, and what are the relations of this middle ear cavity, contents of middle ear cavity, then blood supply, lymphatic drainage, then nerve supply, functions of middle ear, and lastly, applied anatomy of middle ear. You may get this long question over this middle ear. So what is middle ear? Middle ear, it is also called as a tympanic cavity or tympanum. It is air filled space which is present in the petrous part of a temporal bone. The shape and size, it is a roughly cuboidal in shape, and this it is compressed from side to side, that is medial and lateral wall are compressed, and vertical and anteroposterior diameter, it is almost equal, that is about 15 millimeter. On coronal section, you can see that it is a biconcave, and the distance between this medial and lateral wall at the roof or near the roof, it is about 6 millimeter. In the middle, it is about 2 millimeter, and near the floor, it is about the 4 millimeter. So it is having anterior wall, posterior wall, medial wall, lateral wall, one roof is there and one floor is there. So this is a introductory parts of this tympanic cavity or middle ear. And what are the parts of middle ear? This middle ear, it is divided into three parts. We have seen that tympanic membrane, which is attached to the tympanic sulcus, which forms the medial boundary of this external acoustic meatus. So it is a partition between this middle ear or tympanic cavity and external ear. So this is a part just above this tympanic membrane, attachment of this tympanic membrane, that is called as a epitympanic recess. So this portion of middle ear cavity is the epitympanic recess. It consists of a head of malleus, then short process of malleus, then head of incus, as well as anterior process of incus. Then next is the tympanic cavity proper, which lies behind the tympanic membrane. So this is the tympanic cavity proper, which consists of this handle of malleus, then long process of incus and stapes. Okay, and this lower portion, that is called as a hypotympanum. So these are the three parts of this tympanic cavity: above this tympanic membrane, that is epitympanum, then this one is the mesotympanum or tympanic cavity proper, and this one is the hypotympanum. Then next, this nasal, it is connected with this nasopharynx. Tympanic cavity anteriorly connected with this nasopharynx through this Eustachian tube or auditory tube. And posteriorly it is connected to the mastoid antrum through the adytes to the mastoid antrum. So these are the connections of this or communications of the middle ear cavity. So anteriorly through this Eustachian tube or auditory tube, it is connected with the nasopharynx, posteriorly through this mastoid antrum and mastoid air cells through this adytes to mastoid antrum. So this is adytes, this is antrum, and these are the mastoid air cells. And this is attic or tympanic cavity, middle ear cavity is here. So this is a section of this external ear, this one is the middle ear, and okay, and later on there will be an internal ear is there. So this is a middle ear cavity, this one is a lateral wall of the middle ear cavity, this is a roof of the middle ear cavity, and these are the content, that is the three ossicles, ear ossicles, that is the malleus, incus and stapes, which are present in the middle ear cavity, along with this two muscles, that is the tensor tympani muscle and stapedius muscle, that are present in this tympanic cavity. And this is nothing but a auditory canal for the auditory tube. Now we will see this tympanic cavity, it is having roof, we will see boundary one by one: roof, floor, then medial and lateral wall, then anterior and posterior wall. Roof is wider than that of the floor, and this anterior wall, it is narrower than that of the posterior wall, and this medial and lateral wall that are having convexity towards the tympanic cavity. So it is just like a hour inside of the hourglass appearance is there. So this is a, these are the boundaries. First, roof. So this is the roof of the tympanic cavity, which is formed by the thin plate of a bone called tegmental tympani. It also extends posteriorly to form the roof of the adytus to antrum. So this is the roof which is formed by the tegmental tympani. Okay, then it separates this tympanic cavity. This is the tympanic cavity. So this roof separates the tympanic cavity from the middle cranial fossa. Okay, so this one is the roof. Then next is the floor. So this is the floor. In the roof you can see that two nerves, you can see there are the grooves for the greater petrosal nerve and lesser petrosal nerve. Okay, lesser petrosal nerve arising from this tympanic plexus and greater petrosal nerve from the genu of the facial nerve. So these two nerves you can see that which lies over this groove for this, over the roof of the tympanic cavity. It is also called as a tegmental wall. Okay, next is the floor, which is also called as jugular. It is related to the vein. So it is formed by the thin plate of a bone which separates the tympanic cavity from the jugular bulb. Near the medial border of the floor, you can see there is a small aperture through which the tympanic branch of this glossopharyngeal nerve enter into the tympanic cavity. Okay, so these are the structures which are present in the floor. It is related to the jugular bulb. Near the medial border, you can see that this tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve, it enters into this tympanic cavity to form the tympanic plexus. Okay, so this is also called as a venous wall or jugular wall or floor of this tympanic cavity. This is another diagram to show this is the jugular wall. This one is the tegmental tympani, which will forming the roof of this. This is floor. Now this one is the anterior wall, or it is also called as a carotid wall, and this is the posterior wall of this tympanic cavity. So now we see anterior wall. So this is the anterior wall. Okay, roof is over, floor is over, now anterior. So anterior wall, you can see that in the upper part, you can see there is a groove for this, or canal for the muscle, that is the tensor tympani muscle. And below this tensor tympani muscle, one bony projection is there, which will grows or which will extend up to the medial wall, and that will forming a curved structure, and that is called as a processus coccoliformis, which form around which this tensor tympani muscle hooks around this processus coccoliformis to get inserted into the handle of malleus. Okay, so this is a, just remember, in the anterior wall, in the upper part there is a canal for tensor tympani, in the middle part there is a canal for auditory tube. Okay, and in the lower part it is formed by the a bony canal, that is a carotid canal. And in this lower part, you can see that in this bony canal, bony carotid canal, you can see the minute apertures or small apertures are there, through which superior and inferior carotico-tympanic nerves from the sympathetic plexus around this internal carotid artery enters into this tympanic cavity, which will forming the tympanic plexus with tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve. Got it? So this is a anterior wall or carotid wall. It is also called as a carotid wall. It is arterial wall. This one is the venous wall. Okay, so it is having two canals, one for the tensor tympani and one for the stachian tube. Thin plate of one which will forming this posterior wall of this carotid canal, which will forming this lower part of the anterior wall. Okay, it separate this tegmental tympani tympanic cavity from the carotid artery. Okay, and this carotid artery, it is surrounded by a sympathetic plexus, and from this sympathetic plexus two nerves arises, that is carotico-tympanic nerve, which going towards the tympanic cavity, arising from the plexus around the carotid artery. So two are there, one is present above, that is the superior, and one is the inferior carotico-tympanic nerve. So this is nothing but a anterior wall or carotid wall. Then next is the lateral wall, which we have seen in the external ear and this tympanic membrane. It separates this middle ear cavity from the external acoustic meatus. Okay, we have seen on the lateral aspect there is a umbo, you can see that is a concavity or highest point of the convexity of the tympanic membrane is there. Then you can see that there is a pars flaccida and pars tensa, two parts of this tympanic membrane which is attached to this tympanic sulcus. Okay, and when you examine the external ear, you can see that in the anterior inferior quadrant, you can see there is a cone of light that we have seen in the external ear and tympanic last lecture only. Okay, and tympanic membrane. So this tympanic membrane along with this tympanic ring and sulcus, it will forming the lateral wall of this tympanic cavity. This squamous part of a temporal bone, which will forming the lateral wall in the region of this pars flaccida, okay, or in the region of epitympanic recess. Then near the tympanic notch, two small apertures you can see. See that this is the posterior canaliculi, okay, and one is the anterior canaliculi. Through this posterior canaliculi, this cauda tympanic nerve enters, which will passes between this is a tympanic membrane is a trilaminar membrane. So just beneath the mucous membrane, it will enter here into the tympanic membrane and it will exit it through this anterior canaliculus. Okay, so two separate apertures are there near this notch. Then petrotympanic fissure of the upper edge of a bony rim, it will lodges the anterior process of malleus. So this is a malleus, head of malleus, and this is anterior process of malleus and also the anterior ligament of malleus. Okay, then it will also transmit the branch from the maxillary artery. This is anterior canaliculus, also transmit the branch from the maxillary artery. Okay, so this is a lateral wall. Here you can see that in this lateral wall between this membranous and fibrous layer, you can see that there is a attachment of a handle of malleus. It is this head of this malleus articulates with this incus, and this one is the long process of a incus. Okay, so here you can see that there is short process of a malleus and anterior ligament of a malleus. Here also pars flaccida and pars tensa are there. So here you can see this posterior canaliculus, this is a facial canal, and this one is the cauda tympanic branch of a facial nerve, enters into the tympanic cavity and exit through the anterior canaliculus. And this maxillary artery, that is a tympanic branch of a maxillary artery, enters into the tympanic cavity through this anterior canaliculus. So this is about this lateral wall, which is also membranous wall, which is formed by the tympanic membrane. So this is the lateral wall, you can see that same diagram is there. This is anterior wall, tensa tympani, auditory tube, then carotid canal. Superiorly roof is there by this tegment tympani. Inferiorly floor is there, that is a jugular wall, which is related to the jugular bulb. Now this one is the lateral wall, that is via the membranous wall, which is formed by this tympanic membrane. Next is the medial wall of this tympanic membrane. This lateral wall and medial wall, that is having convexity inside the tympanic cavity. So you can see that there are various elevations and depressions or structures which are present on this medial wall. This medial wall separates this tympanic cavity from the inner ear. Okay, you can see that there is a one projection that is called a promontory. Then you can see that there is a one opening is there that is called as an oval window, which is closed by the foot plate of this stapes. Okay, so these are, it is also which is related to the vestibule of this inner ear. So this is called as a fenestra vestibuli. Then just below it you can see that fenestra cochlei or round window you can see. Then tympanic part of a bony facial canal, that is a cord or where it is related to this aditus to antrum. Okay, so that is also related to this medial wall, and also it is also having one elevation that is due to the lateral semicircular canal. And also you can see that there is a processus cochleiformis is there, which we see one by one, these structures, all these which are present on the medial wall. So this is a mastoid antrum, this is a base of the stapes, then this is densa tympani. Okay, this is facial canal is there, this is mastoid ear cells. Okay, so we'll see one by one what are the structures that are present on the medial wall. It is also, it is related to the inner ear, that's why it is also called as a labyrinthine wall. The semicircular canals are related to this wall. So first one is the promontory. It is a rounded elevation. You can see that rounded elevation is there, which is produced by the first turn of a cochlea, and it is grooved by the tympanic plexus. So over this promontory, this tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve and choreticotympanic superior and inferior choreticotympanic nerves together, they forming this plexus which is present over the promontory, and that is called as a tympanic plexus. Okay, so this is nothing but a rounded elevation which is present on the medial wall, which is produced by the first turn of this cochlea. Next is the oval window. Here there is a one window is there that is called as a oval window, which lies behind and above this promontory. This is the promontory and it lies behind and above the promontory. It is a kidney shaped structure or opening that connect the tympanic cavity with the vestibule of the ear, inner ear. Okay, so this is a kidney shaped structure that is called as a oval window, or it is also called as a fenestra vestibuli. It is closed by this foot plate of a stapes. So this is a third ossicle, that is a stapes, and which is having head, neck, and these are the two crura, and this one is the foot plate which closes this oval window. Okay, the size of this oval window is 3.25 millimeter by 1.75 millimeter. So these are, this is another structure. First one is the promontory. Second, you can see that oval window which is closed by the foot plate of a stapes. Then next is, you can see that there is another aperture that is called as a round window. Okay, so this one is the round window, or it is also called as a fenestra cochlei. You have seen that fenestra vestibuli present just behind and above this promontory, and this is present just inferior to this promontory and posterior inferior to the promontory. Okay, so this is the opening at the bottom of the depression of the posterior inferior to the promontory. It opens into the scala tympani of the cochlea, and it is closed by another tympanic membrane that is called a secondary tympanic membrane, which closes this round window. Got it? So first promontory, then fenestra vestibuli, then fenestra cochlei, and there is a depression just behind this promontory that is called as a sinus tympani. So this is a sinus tympani, okay, which indicate the position of ampulla of the posterior semicircular canal, and it is closely related to the apex of cochlea. Got it? So these are the structures which are present over this medial wall of this tympanic cavity. Okay, or that is also called as a labyrinthine wall. Then here there is a prominence of a facial canal. Here you can see this is the oblique part of the facial nerve. It runs just backward above the fenestra vestibuli. This is the fenestra vestibuli. Above this fenestra vestibuli, you can see that there is a prominence of a facial canal. So this is a prominence of a facial canal, which forming the lower margin of this adducts to the antrum. Okay. It descends behind the posterior wall to end into the vertical part of this facial canal and end into the stylomastoid foramen. Okay. So this is the prominence of facial canal, which you can see on the medial wall of this tympanic cavity. Then next is the processus cochleiformis. This is a bony septum which separates the two canals above, canal for tensa tympani or groove for tensa tympani, and below groove for the auditory tube. And it is continued posteriorly on the medial wall as a curved lamina, and that is called as a processus cochleiformis. Okay, and it forms a pulley around which this tendon of this tensa tympani turns laterally to get inserted into the upper part of a handle of malleus. So these are the structures which are present on this medial wall of the tympanic cavity. Next is the posterior wall. This posterior wall, it is related to the facial nerve. Okay, we have seen this is the roof related to the greater and lesser petrosal nerve. Anterior wall related to this keratico-tympanic nerves. This is the floor which is related to the tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve. Okay, then this is the related to the facial nerve. Medial wall is also related to this whole of the tympanic plexus as well as facial nerve. Okay, now posterior wall, it is a adducts to the antrum to which epitympanic recess communicate with the mastoid or tympanic antrum. Okay, adducts to this tympanic antrum, you can see in the posterior or on the posterior wall. Then fossa incudus, that is a depression which lodges the short process of incus. That is, the incus is having long process and short process, so this posteriorly it lodges the short process of incus. Then bulge produced by the lateral semicircular canal. So this is a lateral bulge produced by this lateral semicircular canal. If you go downward, you can see that there is a bony projection, that is called conical projection, is there. Yes, near the junction of this posterior and medial wall. This fenestra vestibuli present on the medial wall, and this is a posterior wall. This projection is called as a pyramid. This is a pyramidal eminence, and this is apex of pyramid. Okay, so this apex of pyramid, you can see that there is a passage of tendon of stapedius muscle. Okay, so these are the structures which you can see on this posterior wall. First, adductus to antrum is there. Then one fossa is there, that is called a fossa incudus, that is the depression which lodges the short process of this incus. We will see in next diagram. Okay, then bulge produced by the lateral semicircular canal. Then you can see there is a pyramidal eminence which will having passage for this stapedius muscle. Okay, then tendon of stapedius. Then next is the vertical canal, that is a vertical bony canal which will also produces this eminence on this posterior wall. Okay, of a facial nerve. So these are the structures which are present on the posterior wall, or it is also called as it is related to the mastoid process, it is also called as a mastoid wall. Then you can see there is a one recess is there, that is called as a facial recess. It is a groove which lies between the pyramid with the facial nerve and annulus of the tympanic membrane. So this is a annulus of a tympanic membrane, and this one is called as a facial recess. Then posteriorly you can see that mastoid antrum is there. So this is a mastoid antrum. So roof of mastoid antrum separate it from this middle cranial fossa. Laterally you can see there is a bone, that is the squamous part of temporal bone is there. medial wall and which is posteriorly and horizontal semicircular canal are present. So medial wall separate this mastoid antrum from the posterior and horizontal semicircular canal. Lateral wall, squamous part of a temporal bone. Posteriorly it is communicating with the several openings with the mastoid cells. Okay, and you can approach this mastoid antrum through this Macevans triangle or supramiatal triangle, which we will see later on. So this is nothing but a mastoid antrum. Okay, so this mastoid antrum, posteriorly it is communicating with this several mastoid air cells. Then mastoid air cells that vary considerably in number, form and size, that are interconnected with each other and lined by a squamous non-ciliated epithelium. Okay, see that this is the adytes to the mastoid antrum, these are the mastoid air cells and this is mastoid process, this is tympanic cavity. These are all related in the posterior or related to the posterior wall or mastoid wall of this. Got it? See that this is a malleus and this one is the incus. So this short process of incus is present here. This is long process of incus which will articulating with this head of the stapes, and this one is the stapedius muscle. This is a posterior wall. Okay, this is a tympanic membrane, this is a tympanic sulcus, this is tensor tympani muscle and this is a pharyngotympanic or auditory tube. Now these are the boundaries of this tympanic cavity, that is the roof formed by the tegmental tympani, floor which is formed by the plate, that is the inferior surface of a petrous part of a temporal bone which will separate it from the superior bulb of a internal jugular vein. Anteriorly there is a passage for tensor tympani as well as auditory tube. Then below there is a carotid canal, posterior wall of this carotid canal is there. Then medial wall which is related to the inner ear, which shows this various promontory, vestibular, finestra vestibular, finestra cochlea, all the structures which are present on the medial wall. Then laterally tympanic membrane is there, posteriorly it is also called as a mastoid wall. So these are the six walls of this middle ear cavity. Now we'll see what are the contents of middle ear cavity. First one is the ear is there, then ossicles are there, three ear ossicles, malleus, incus and stapes. Okay, out of that malleus and incus that develops from the first pharyngeal arch and stapes develops from the second pharyngeal arch. Then two muscles are there, tensor tympani which develops from the mesoderma first pharyngeal arch and stapedius from the second pharyngeal arch. Then two nerves are there, one is the caudal tympanic branch of facial nerve and tympanic plexus. Then all this tympanic cavity that is covered by this mucosa, mucous membrane which having various folds. So these folds are present inside this tympanic cavity. Then it also encircles these ligaments, all these ear ossicles, muscles and blood vessels. Okay, just like a peritoneum of the abdomen. So we will see one by one. First ear is present, then next is the ossicles are there. So first ossicle is the malleus, that is also called as a hammer. It is the largest, it is having three parts, that is a head, neck and handle. Okay, so this is a head, this one is a neck and this is a handle. Then it is having two processes, one is the lateral process and one is the anterior process. So two processes are there, one handle is there. So this portion that is present in the epitympanic part of a tympanic cavity, head and neck, that is present in the epitympanum. Handle that lies in the fibrous layer of this tympanic membrane. Okay, it is suspended by these two malleolar folds or two malleal ligament which are attached to this lateral process of this malleus. Okay, this lateral process gives attachment to these two folds from the tympanic anatus, and this head articulates with the incus to form a saddle variety of a synovial joint. Okay, so this is the first ossicle, that is a malleus. Then next is the incus, that is also called as the anvil. So it is resembles a molar tooth. Parts its body is there, which is large and bears an articular facet which is directed forward and articulates with the head of the malleus, which forming the joint, that is a saddle variety of a joint. It is having two processes, that is a short process and long process. The short process project backward, okay, and connected by ligament or to the fossa incudus. So this is a short process, and this long process, it goes downward parallel to the handle of malleus, then it turns medially and form a lentiform process, okay, so which articulates with the head of the stapes, and that will forming another synovial joint, a ball and sockets variety of a synovial joint. So this is about the incus, another ossicle. Third ossicle is a stapes, or it is also called a stirrup. So it is having head which articulates with the lentiform nodule of the incus, forming ball and socket joint. Just beneath that you can see that neck, constricted portion is there, that is the neck, and this neck provides the insertion for the tendon of stapedius. Then two crura are there, anterior and posterior crura, anterior and posterior limb. So out of the anterior is a short less cord and posterior is a more cord, and beneath that you can see that that arising from this neck and going towards the foot plate or base. So this is a base or foot plate which fits into the finestra vestibuli. Okay, so this is a third ossicle, that is the stapes, which derived from the second pharyngeal arch. So joints, that is the incudomalleolar joint between the incus, body of the incus, and the head of the malleus. Okay, and type of joint is a saddle variety of a joint. Second one is the incudostapedial joint. This one is the lentiform process and also by the head of this stapes, that will forming the ball and socket variety of a joint. Got it? So these are the joints. They increases the amplitude of the vibration, that is 15 to 20 times, because of the leverage of a and eardrum to the oval window ratio, that is the synovial joints between them, they will cause help in the transmission of a sound wave. Okay, so this is ear ossicle. Then next content is the muscles of middle ear. Two muscles are there, one is the tensor tympani, another is the stapedius. Tensor tympani arising from the wall of auditory tube as well as wall of a own canal. Okay, then where it is inserted? It is inserted on the handle of malleus. This and a nerve supply, as it is derived from the first pharyngeal arch, that is the mandibular division of a trigeminal nerve. What is the action? It dampens down the vibration of tympanic membrane, that is the tensor tympani. Then next muscle is the stapedius, that is the pyramid or bony projections on the posterior wall of a middle ear. From there it arises, also inserted on the neck of a stapes muscle. This muscle derived from the mesoderm of a second pharyngeal arch, so it is supplied by the facial nerve. Action, it dampens down the vibrations of the stapes. So these are the muscles and ear ossicles. See that this is a posterior ligament which is attached to this incus, and this one is the anterior ligament of a malleus. Okay, this is the tensor tympani muscle and this one is the stapedius muscle. This is a ball and socket joint and this one is a saddle joint. This is the fossa incudus. Okay, and this is the petrotympanic fissure or anterior canaliculus, which are present in this middle ear cavity. The next content of the middle ear nerves are there. So first is the cauda tympanic nerve, which is a branch of facial nerve. It enters the tympanic cavity through this posterior canaliculus. Okay, at the junction of lateral and posterior wall. It runs across the medial surface of the tympanic membrane. Okay, so this is the tympanic membrane. It runs on the medial surface of the tympanic membrane between mucosal and fibrous layer. Okay, then passes medial to the upper portion of the handle of meninges. Medial to the upper portion of the handle of malleus, above the tendon of tensor tympani. Here there is a tensor tympani muscle. Okay, above it, this is tensor tympani and this one is the chorda tympani. Above it, it crosses this handle of malleus muscle. Then it leaves the petrotympanic fissure. It, what is the function of this chorda tympani? Now we have seen. That is, it conveys the taste fibers from the anterior 2/3 of the tongue except valid papillae, and also it gives the preganglionic secretomotor fibers to salivary glands, that is the submandibular and sublingual salivary gland. This is important nerve which is present on this lateral wall of this middle ear cavity. Then next nervous component is the tympanic plexus. We have seen that it is formed by the tympanic branch of glossopharyngeal nerve, which is also called as Jacobson nerve, and carotico-tympanic nerves, which arises from the sympathetic plexus around the internal carotid artery. Two are there, superior and inferior. These nerves form the plexus on the promontory and provide the branches to the mucous membrane lining the tympanic cavity, Eustachian tube and mastoid antrum, as well as mastoid air cells. This plexus also gives branches which joins the greater superficial petrosal and lesser superficial petrosal nerve that contains all parasympathetic fibers of this glossopharyngeal nerve. So this tympanic plexus is also one of the content of this tympanic cavity or middle ear cavity. Then next is the mucosa of the middle ear cleft. So mucus secrete, it is lined by a mucous membrane and it is lined by mucus secreting cells. Okay, and it is lined by respiratory epithelium, that is a tall columnar ciliated epithelium is there. In some species the cilia are absent. Okay, it lines the bony wall of the tympanic cavity and wraps the middle ear structures like ossicle, muscles, ligaments and nerves, like the peritoneum of the abdomen, visceral peritoneum of the abdomen. So these are the content of the middle ear cavity. Then next is the blood supply. So in that arterial supply, two main arteries supply this middle ear cavity. One is the anterior tympanic branch of a maxillary artery, which we have seen, which enters into the tympanic cavity through this anterior canaliculus. Then stylomastoid branch of a posterior auricular artery. So these two main arteries are there and four minor arteries are there. That is a petrosal branch of middle meningeal artery, then superior tympanic branch of middle meningeal artery, then branch of artery of pterygoid canal and tympanic branch of internal carotid artery. So total six arteries supplies the middle ear. Got it? That is a branch of a maxillary, branch of a posterior auricular, middle meningeal, then also tympanic branch of a middle meningeal artery and artery of a pterygoid canal, artery of tympanic branch of a internal carotid. And this venous blood from this middle ear going into the pterygoid venous plexus as well as superior petrosal sinus. That's why infections from the middle ear transmit towards this superior petrosal sinus or towards this pterygoid venous plexus. Lymphatic drainage, that is into the retropharyngeal group of lymph node, also parotid group of lymph node and upper deep cervical group of lymph nodes. Nerve supply, we have seen that there is a presence of large plexus is there, that is a tympanic plexus which is present over the promontory and which is formed by the tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve as well as superior and inferior carotico tympani nerve. So which will supply the middle ear. Then functions of middle ear. It transmits the sound waves from the external to internal ear through a chain of ear ossicle. It transforms the airborne vibrations from the tympanic membrane to the liquid-borne vibrations to the internal ear. The intensity of sound waves is increased 10 times by this ossicular chain, but the frequency does not change. Okay, it will increase the intensity, but frequency will not change. Lastly, applied anatomy of the middle ear. In this fracture of a middle cranial fossa, when there is a fracture, there will be a bleed through the ear, that is through the roof. There will be a passage of this blood and it will come out through the ear along with the discharge of a CSF. Then throat infections spread to the middle ear through opening, that is the communication between the middle ear and nasopharynx through the auditory tube. When infections are there, it may lead to a middle ear from the in the throat, it may lead to the middle ear infection, and from this middle ear infection it may rupture this tympanic membrane. Okay, laterally it may rupture the tympanic membrane, that is through the lateral wall. Okay, if it may spread through the roof into the middle cranial fossa and it will cause the meningitis, also brain abscess, also thrombosis of sigmoid sinus. Then it may go inferiorly through this floor to the internal jugular vein, or it may go posteriorly forming this mastoid abscess. Okay, so this throat infections may reach into the this area through the middle ear infection, and infection of middle ear is called as a otitis media. There may be acute and chronic otitis media. This may lead to a persistent discharge of a pus through the ears. Then next, you can write down about the inflammation of auditory tube, that is also called as STH and catarrh, that is secondary to the common cold. Okay, by giving decongestion steam, you can relieve this inflammation of a auditory tube. Then next, you can write down about the otosclerosis, that is a bony fusion takes place between the foot plate of a stapes and the margins of fenestra vestibuli, which leads to the deafness that may be corrected by putting the prosthosis. Okay, then mastoid abscess, which can be drained through this supramyatal triangle, which we will see what are the boundaries of supramyatal triangle. And lastly, there is hyperacusis. Due to this paralysis of stapedius muscle, this movement of stapes are dampened, so sound get distorted and get too high in volume. Okay, that is called as hyperacusis due to paralysis of stapedius muscle. Okay, so these are the points of applied anatomy. So this is a Mass-7 triangle through which we can approach towards this mastoid antrum. Okay, to drain the mastoid abscess, superiorly superior temporal line is there, anteriorly posterior superior margin of the external, this one is the external acoustic meatus, so this is the external anterior line which will forming the posterior superior margin of bony external opening. Okay, then posteriorly a tangent line is drawn to the midpoint of the posterior wall, okay, of external auditory canal. It contains a spine of a Henle. This mastoid antrum lies 12 to 15 millimeter deep to this point, and that is called a Mass-7 triangle or supramyatal triangle. To drain this abscess, this position we must know. So this is the oval window. This there is a otosclerosis. It can be corrected by this putting this prosthesis. Okay, prosthesis of stapes, foot plate of stapes. We have seen the development of a ear. This is a first pharyngeal pouch which will forming the tubotympanic recess, and that will forming the middle ear cavity. This is a first pharyngeal cleft which will forming the external acoustic meatus. Okay, and this structures at the junction, that is the pharyngeal membrane is there, that will forming the tympanic membrane, trilaminar tympanic membrane. Then these are the ear ossicles, that is the malleus and incus, that will develop from the Meckel's cartilage, which is the cartilage of a first pharyngeal arch, and second pharyngeal arch gives the stapes, that is the Richard's cartilage, which will develops into the stapes. So these are the ear ossicles which develops from these pharyngeal arches. These are these ear ossicles and various joints between these two joints, incudostapedial joint, this one, and this is the malleo-incudous joint. that is saddle variety and ball and socket variety of a joint. So this is all about this middle ear. Any doubt you can ask. So we will see that is the boundaries in short, or summarize this boundaries of middle ear: lateral wall, that is the membranous wall. It is formed by the tympanic membrane as well as squamous portion of a temporal bone. Medial wall, that is also called as the labyrinthine wall. Here you can see that promontory, that is the outer wall of inner, as well as you can see that oval window, round window, then prominence of a facial nerve. Then anterior wall, it is also called as the carotid wall, that is the opening of a statuent tube and tendon of a tensor tympani. You have seen on the anterior wall. Posterior wall or mastoid wall, additus to the mastoid cells, fossa incudas, pyramidal eminence, then facial nerve through the tympanic sulcus. Okay, so these things you can see, you have seen in the posterior wall. Inferior wall or jugular wall or venous wall, you have seen there is a one nerve, that is a tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve is there. Then superior wall or tegmental wall, which is formed by the tegment tympani. Okay, and it is related to the greater petrosal and lesser petrosal nerve. So all these walls of a middle ear that are related to the nerves. Okay, laterally you have seen the caudal tympanic nerve. Okay, medially you have seen tympanic plexus and facial nerve. Anteriorly carotico-tympanic nerve. Posteriorly facial nerve is there also. Inferiorly tympanic branch of a glossopharyngeal nerve. And superiorly greater and lesser petrosal nerve. All the walls are related to the nerves. Then contents of middle ear cavity: three ossicles, malleus, incus and stapes. Ligaments are there: anterior ligament of malleus, lateral ligament of malleus, superior ligament of a malleus, then posterior ligament of incus, annular ligament at the base of a stapes. Two muscles, tensor tympani and stapedius muscle. Vessels that is supplying and draining the middle ear cavity. Then nerves are there, that is the caudal tympanic nerve and tympanic plexus, and lastly the ear. So this is in short about the middle ear. Okay, if there is any doubt you can ask me. Thank you.